به برنامه نان گل و سرخ خوش اومدید. سلام به همگی دوستان، من مریم نمازی ام
و من فریبرز پویا هستم.
در برنامه این هفته در رابطه با هیئت سوئد، زنان فمینیست که رفتن به ایران و حجاب به سر شدن، در ضمن فتوای احمقانمون از پاکستان و قربانی یک بز بدبخت جلوی پرواز پاکستان ایر برای حفظ امنیت اون هواپیما، لحظه زیبای زندگیمونم در رابطه با یک روز در دفاع از مهاجرین در آمریکاست.
اما مصاحبه این هفتمون با راهیلا گوپتاست در رابطه با زنان در روژاوا.
حتما با ما باشید، جای ندید. هفته پیش یک هیئتی از سوئد به ایران رفت و میدونیم که خب این یک دولت به اصطلاح فمینیست سوئد بودن که اومدن حجاب به سر کردن و انگار نه انگار که یک جنگ و دعوایی تو ایران وجود داره علیه حجاب اجباری و واقعا وقتی این عکس‌ها رو آدم میبینه واقعا فکر میکنه که بعد همشون خجالت بکشن به خاطر این کارش.
دقیقاً. و یکی از صحبت‌های دفاعی رو که اندلند وزیر تجارت سوئد میکنه میگه که خب چیکار کنیم، بریم اونجا قوانین جامعه رو زیر پا بذاریم؟
بله.
جامعه دولت
بله.
قوانین دولتی رو زیر پا بذاریم؟
دقیقاً.
میگفت آلترناتیوش اینه که یک دلیگیشن، یک گروه چیز بفرستیم، مرد بفرستیم. نه، یه راه دیگه هم وجود داره. یه راه دیگه اینه که از اعتراض بکنیم و بگیم ما حاضر نیستیم به ایران به خاطر نقض حقوق زنان در ایران حاضر نیستیم بریم اونجا، و تا زمانی که این اجازه رو به ما ندین، همونطوری که حق داشته باشیم هر جوری که میخوان لباس بپوشیم رو، دقیقا همون خواست رو که زنای ایران دارن رو، اینو میتونستین اعلام بکنین، میتونستین نرین. چرا؟ به خاطر اینکه اون بهره سود تجاری تنها موضوع و تنها میزان موفقیت و یا شکست شماست.
و خب ما میدونیم که حجاب واقعا با زور و با سرکوب توی ایران اعمال شده، آسیب پاشی توی صورت زنا، زندانی، اذیت و آزار گشتای زهرا و غیره. و خب ما میدونیم که یک مبارزه خیلی واقعا وسیع داره علیه حجاب اجباری تو ایران صورت میگیره. خب مشخصه که میتونستن به جای اینکه بیان و به این قانون واقعا ناعادلانه ازش رعایت کنن، میتونستن زیر پا بذارن این قانون رو، همونطوری که خیلیا در دوران آپارتاید نژادی توی آفریقای شمالی این کارو کردن، حاضر نشدن تن بدن به یه سیستمی که کسی که سفید و سیاه رو از هم جدا میکنه و نابرابر میدونه. خب این آپارتاید جنسی هم همون نوع نابرابریه، ولی متاسفانه اینا واقعا چجوری به خودشون جرأت میدن که به خودشون بگن فمینیست، یعنی مدافع زن از نظر خودشون، و از اون ور بیان و از این نوع قانون حمایت کنن و رعایت کنن.
اینا باید در واقع بهشون گفت فمینیست های دولتی که تنها موضوع و میزان فمینیسمشون و مقدار اون زنجیرشون فقط با نرخ سودش رو که از تجارتش میبرن. اینا ربطی به مبارزین حقوق زنان توی دنیا ندارن و دقیقا همین کاری رو که توی با زنا توی ایران میکنن و همون به شکل غیر مسئولیت این رفتار رو میکنن تو ایران، همین رفتار هم توی جوامع سوئد میکنن، تو خود سوئد تحت نام کامیونیتی ها و
احترام به جوامع مهاجر.
اسلامی ها رو، دست اسلامی ها رو باز میکنن و حقوق زنان رو در واقع ازش دفاع نمیکنن در سوئد. اینا خیلی برنامه و سیاست کاملا یکسانی رو دارن و به حق به وسیله کسایی توی میدیای اجتماعی وسایل ارتباط جمعی محکوم شدن و اینا دوستا و هوادارای زنان و حقوق برابر زنان و مردان در ایران نیستن.
چندی پیش مصاحبه داشتم با راهیلا گوپتا. ایشون یک خبرنگارن که چند بار رفتن روژاوا، کردستان سوریه، و در رابطه با وضعیت اونجا و پروژه اونها برای برابری زن و مرد کلی نوشتن، صحبت کردن و یه صحبت جالبی میکنن در رابطه با اینکه اونجا توی روژاوا داره زنان بارون زنان میاد، به خاطر اینکه انقدر تمرکز هست روی برابری بین زن و مرد، به خصوص توی وجوه قانونی.
دقیقا ما در شرایط این رو داریم میبینیم که توی اون منطقه هر دولتی که وجود داره حقوق زنان رو پایمال میکنه، تمام احزاب اسلامی که اونجا حضور دارن و نیرو دارن قوانین شریعه رو اعمال میکنن. توی این وسط توی اون مناطق آزاد شده اومدن نیروهای کرد و زنای پیشمرگه کرد اومدن پرچم برابری زن و مرد رو هوا کردن و تو تمام سطوح سازمان دولتی و اجتماعی دارن اجرا میکنن.
و چیزی که
واقعا زیباست
و یه چیزی که جالب اینه که به یاد منو به یاد اون روزا میافته میندازه که همیشه میگن خب الان نمیشه در رابطه با برابری زن و مرد صحبت کرد، به خاطر اینکه ما دشمنای خیلی بزرگتری داریم از نمیدونم کشورهایی که دارن استثمار میکنن تا مثلا دولت‌های امپریالیست، یا مثلا الان وقتش نیست، انقلاب داریم، کارهای مهمتری داریم میکنیم. و اینکه چقدر مهمه که تو هر شرایطی، حتی تو شرایط جنگ زده روژاوا که دوره توی همون وسط جنگ داره صورت میگیره، میشه پایبند بود به خواست برابری زن و مرد.
دقیقاً. و کسایی هستن که انتقاد میکنن، مثلا میگن پکاکا اونجا هست، نیروهاش هستن، این نوع سوسیالیسم محلی و دول پایینی و شهرداری به درد نمیخوره، یا اینکه هیچ نیروی غیر از هوادارهای پکاکا با پیجه نمیتونه اونجا فعالیت کنن. تمام اینا درسته و بعد بهش انتقاد کرد، وسیع‌ترین آزادی‌های سیاسی رو خواستار شد، ولی سر یه نکته ای رو تو این دنیا یه پرچم برابری زن و مرد رو تو سطوح مختلف گذاشتن، از این قضیه باید به شدت دفاع کرد و ما تو این برنامه حتما این کارو میکنیم.
به هر حال حتما بشینید الان مصاحبه راهیلا گوپتا رو با ما نگاه کنید، واقعا مصاحبه جالبیه، با ما باشید.
Rahila Gupta, it's a great pleasure to have you on our program. You've been to Rojava, you've written about it. Tell us how such a project for gender equality can be possible in such difficult circumstances.
Yeah, well, that's a question I asked myself as well before I actually made the trip to Rojava. And it really is something, if you've never heard about it before, it's something that you wouldn't believe. That was my initial reaction. And I think I was probably one of the last journalists to be able to cross the border, because all the borders are shut as well. So it's very, very isolated. And what I found was really amazing. There is an experiment that's going on in radical democracy. So it's about direct participatory democracy. So neighborhoods form into communes, and every commune is led by a man and a woman, and there are several committees on that. So there'll be a committee to deal with health issues or education, or what they call conflict resolution, which is often to do with domestic violence, and each of those will be led by a man and a woman, and then it goes upwards to the next level and the next level and the next level up to the city level. And they all elect the next level of leadership. Parallel to this, so there is this whole system that, you know, energizes society, is a whole autonomous women's structure as well, which makes sure that there's a feminist perspective on every single issue. And they have the same structure. So they have, but except that it is women only, so they will have, you know, committees at the neighborhood level and right up to the city level. So if you talk in terms of, you know, in order to make sure that there is gender equality, do you tilt the field in favor of women? Yes, you do. You have to. Now, this is going on in the middle of war. Syria, as everybody knows, is completely war-torn. What do we hear about this place? I mean, I am shocked by the level of ignorance about Rojava in the West, amongst progressive people, amongst politically active people. Partly it's to do with the fact that the media is not interested. When I was crossing the border, I met journalists who were going straight to the front line, because what they want is war, brutality, violence. And there is a society behind all of this, which is really, I would argue, the most radical democracy, attempt at building a radical democracy in the world. And so it takes you back on many different fronts because, you know, there's the whole kind of clash of civilizations narrative in the West, you know, that there is this monolithic Islamic backward culture and you have, you know, all the best values in the world are attached to Western civilization, respect for democracy, human rights, equality, etc., etc. And then here you have in Syria a part of it. So I have to tell you the geographical, it's the northernmost strip of Syria going from east to west, and it's kind of bordering the Turkish, the southern part of Turkey. And on their south, they are facing the ISIS so-called caliphate. And one of the reasons that we sometimes hear about them in the West is because we see the women's defense forces out there fighting the good fight against ISIS. Now, they've been the most effective fighting force against ISIS, so they've had the advantage of American air cover. But, you know, it's America has a particular project there. It wants to get rid of ISIS. And so the support that it's giving Rojava is very, very qualified. And what's going to happen, I suspect, I fear, is that all of these people are, as soon as the war against ISIS is won, and the Rojava forces will win this fight. They have been incredibly disciplined. They are very reliable. There is none of the ragtag internecine fighting of the rest of the Syrian rebels. There is none of the kind of conservative, religious, you know, ideology driving. This is a totally secular state, and I'll come to that in a little while. So basically, that is one of the reasons we've heard a little bit about them. It's because they have this effective fighting force against ISIS, and they are moving on Raqqa as we speak. Apparently, it's entered the third stage. So, but once ISIS goes, what could have been a model solution for the rest of Syria, if there were these self-governing administrative areas like the ones that have been set up in the north across Syria, where the local people themselves could participate in the whole political process and decision making, I think we would have a way forward. But I think it's too dangerous as an idea because it's anti-capitalist. It's very, very into sustaining the, talking about sustaining the environment and taking ecologically sound decisions. And all of this is, people ask, so how did this come about? You know, why did this happen? How come? So it really is the one unsung example of the success of the so-called Arab Spring, because in 2011, when there were all these uprisings across the Middle East, similar uprising took place amongst the Kurdish community in the northern part. And because Assad was very keen on focusing his firepower on the rebels in the south, he basically left them to get on with it.
When you talk about how the system is set up, but what are some practical ways in which women's rights are being protected and promoted?
Okay, well, the Women's Ministry only set up in January 2014, and since then they have abolished dowry, they've abolished polygamy, they've abolished or criminalized or banned forced marriage, honor killings. The Sharia system has been disbanded. It's the only part of Syria in which the Sharia courts have been totally disbanded, because you've got the Sharia system under the Syrian rebels, and you've also, and Assad, for Assad, that was the way in which he delivered justice to all his religious minorities. So that's been abolished. And what I thought, particularly as an Indian, I thought one of the things which is really interesting was not just ending forced marriage, but criminalizing anybody who stops a woman getting married of her own free will. You know, so a so-called love marriage, if that is stopped in its tracks, that person, their family would be criminalized. So these are quite amazing things. And when I met a group called SARA, which I suppose the closest the parallel would be Southall Black Sisters, they were saying that since all the legislation had passed, they felt that, you know, violence against women had halved. So they're saying, none of them are saying that we have arrived. Everybody talks about the thousands of years in which patriarchy has been entrenched. But, you know, in so many different ways. I mean, when I was there, I was hosted by different families. So every night I spent a different night with a different family. So I got to see, you know, families, you know, and how they operated in quite an intimate setting. And, you know, one woman who had been married at the age of 14 and had 7 kids and had been illiterate, was now, since the revolution, had been going to classes in Kurdish, and she learned, so, you know, she could now read and write. And when we were watching TV, and if it was subtitled, she would delightedly point to the words and, you know, read them out. So, and then she also started, because her kids have all grown up now, and she says, you know, I will never choose their husbands for them, for the daughters. They can have their own marriages. And she also does conflict resolution. So she goes off to her local commune and will go and, you know, talk to families where there is violence and try and resolve it. And of course, if it's not resolved, then they have to go through the court system.
Do you feel that this magnificent movement is getting the support that it needs from people who are progressive and living outside of Rojava in the West, for example?
Well, I'm actually really disappointed by the what I would have expected to from, you know, progressives to support this. I've been really disappointed. So, for example, I think partly to do with the fact that they have had, Rojava has had both the support of the Russian army from time to time, as well as the Americans. Both of them, imperial forces, have made the traditional left rather suspicious. As far as the Rojava people are concerned, they say, we have to take whatever support we can get. We do not have the armaments and we do not have, you know, basically the resources to fight somebody like ISIS, so we need to do that. Then I find that the feminist movement, although I find that particularly baffling, you know, so like the Women's International Peace League, they are not supporting it, and I can't actually get to the bottom of it. I mean, they're talking about the amount of Syrian women who are doing human rights work in the rebel areas and are disappointed that they have only 2% representation of women in the councils over there. And they're talking in terms of, we should lobby the funders to make sure that aid is dependent on 30% representation of women. So then I ask them, but in Rojava there's 40 to 50% representation of women without, you know, conditionalities on aid. Why aren't you supporting that? And I think part of it is they cannot get their head around the issue of non-violence, that they have faced a tradition, they have supported a tradition of non-violence and seen militarization as something that is masculine, and have not fully understood that self-defense is really important, and that non-violence can be a privileged position for people who don't face that kind of dilemma. So you don't get, you know, support from that group of people. Then you have other commentators and left-wing organization groups here who support the Syrian rebels. And when you ask them, but the Syrian rebels actually, you know, first of all, as we know, that the rebel army is just a ragtag group of, you know, various Islamist organizations. And don't you think we ought to be confronting the fact that if these rebels were successful, what kind of a post-Assad society are we talking about? You know, where is your support for secularism? And they are not prepared to counter to understand these issues. All they see is Assad is a dictator. We have to unseat him in any shape or in any way we can, and not really looking at who are the people who are doing the unseating.
And of course there are some groups on the left that support the Assad regime.
Yes.
But I guess the main issue is Rojava is it's raining women, you say in one of your articles. I guess the question is, it does hold something really important, and even as a symbol for what could possibly be in the Middle East and North Africa. It represents a different world.
Yeah. I mean, even for the world. Yeah. I think that its ambitions and its aspirations are unmatched. I think even in the West, we are simply do not have that level of ambition about the kind of society we want to see. And I think it is such an important experiment. It is so important to support it that I really think, first of all, we need to spread the word. You know, people need to know about Rojava. But it requires the kind of support it requires, I feel, is like lobbying at that level of, you know, Turkey needs to back off. But if Turkey has to back off, America has to put pressure on Turkey. What kind of an American president do we have at the moment? You know, it's like there's about, you know, 10 or 15 foreign powers with the real interest in that area, which is what's making it really difficult to marshal support for Rojava. But as an idea, the fact that this experiment can be even tried in a war-torn area with no medicines, you know, shortage of food, all sorts of issues and complications, people migrating into and leaving. You know, there's a huge amount of refugees coming in. Nobody's paying the blindest bit of heed to that. They need aid for that. You know, Mosul, now that Mosul is coming, well, probably the war there is coming to an end. There are refugees entering Rojava from there. So they are facing a really difficult situation, and to be able to have this, you know, this, not just to say that another world is possible, but in fact that another world is here and we are making it and we are creating it. We, all of us, really need to support it. So I feel very passionate about Rojava.
Thank you very much.
Okay.
فتوای احمقانه این هفته از پاکستانه و وقتی که پاکستان ایر متاسفانه یک سقوط کرده بود یکی از هواپیماهاش و بعد از یه مدتی وقتی قرار بود که دوباره مجدداً پروازها شروع بشه، اولین پرواز همین پاکستان ایر که قرار بود اجازه داده شده بود بهش که بتونه پرواز کنه، قبل از پرواز چند تا از کارمندای اون هواپیما فکر کردن خب بیا یه بزو چیز کنیم،
قربانی
کنیم که حادثه دیگه پیش نیاد،
جلوی
همونجا
پما یه بز بیچاره یه سیاه رو گرفتن سرشو چیز قربانی کردن. آدم مونده که در با این برداشتای مذهبی توی دنیا و چیکار که یه طرف تو ایران به جای این که از محیط زیست دفاع کنن میرن حوزه علمیه قم، کارمندای
بز بدبخت گرفتن،
شرکت هواپیمایی پاکستان میرن قربانی بز میکنن. آخه بین
علم یا
سیفتی چک و چکی مثلا
که
همه چی درست باشه افغان چک کردن در
یا بز
بیچاره رو
خیلی سخته، معلوم نیست چی رو باید انتخاب
کنه. آخه چقدر دنیای سختی است با مذهب، بعد باهای احمقانه تأثیر مذهب دیوانه روی زندگی مردم.
لحظه زیبای زندگی این هفته از آمریکاست و اعتراضات روز 16 فوریه، روز بدون مهاجرین، و این یک روز اعتراضی بود علیه سیاست‌های ضد خارجی و راسیست دونالد ترامپ. واقعا یه روز واقعا باشکوه، وقتی عکس‌ها و ویدیوها رو آدم می‌بینه واقعا باعث دلگرمی میشه.
دقیقاً، و روزی بود که مرد خیلی از خانواده‌ها بچه‌هاشون مدرسه نفرستادن، خیلی از کارها، رستوران ها، مغازه ها و تمام بیزنس ها در بسته شدن به خاطر اینکه مهاجرین حاضر نشدن سر کار برن، و در واقع یه روزی رو بود نشون داد که آمریکا رو چیزی که عظیم میکنه مهاجراش بودن همیشه و خواهند بود، و این تصویریه که در واقع قضیه مهاجرت و مهاجرین در تمام کشورها و نقشی که بازی میکنن و این به رسمیت شناختن این برای هر کشوری از ایران، خاورمیانه، کشورهای خلیج فارس، اروپا نشون دهنده روح و آینده هر جامعه خواهد.
به هر حال امیدواریم از برنامه این هفته خوشتون اومده باشه. تا هفته آینده روزها و شبای خیلی خوبی داشته باشین. تا اون موقع بای.
Goodbye.
Hi, I'm Mariam Namazi.
And I'm Fari Bospuya.
We're hosting a program called Bread and Roses. It's a weekly program that's broadcast in Persian and English in the Middle East and North Africa, primarily Iran as well. And it's also shown on YouTube internationally.
And we've been doing this since last May. We're coming up to our year's anniversary. And yeah. We've had quite a lot of fun making these videos.
We discuss taboo-breaking, free-thinking ideas. The Islamic regime of Iran has called us immoral and corrupt.
And that's why you need to support us. We are and the alternative voice in Middle East and North Africa.
Of corruption and immorality. So do support us. Here's a short video from Patreon that explains how you can help us with even just $1 a week. That's nothing. Support us.
Patreon lets fans become patrons of their favorite artists and content creators. It's different than Kickstarter because it's not about one big project that requires lots of funding. It's more for bloggers or YouTubers or webcomics, anyone who creates on a regular basis. Here's how it works. When you become a patron, you're agreeing to give an artist a tip of an amount you set every time they release a piece of content, whether it's a new song, a video, or a recipe. You can set a monthly maximum to make sure that you're always within your budget. Choose an amount, enter your payment information, and you're done. Becoming a patron allows you to view and post in the artist's stream, and in exchange for your support, artists offer additional patron packages, which might include monthly Google Hangouts, music production tutorials, pre-sale concert tickets, or anything they can offer as a way to say thanks. Patreon, empowering a new generation of content creators.